Hi again, everyone. I'm sorry that I got cut off before, but PetSmart had called me and told me that the dogs were done. And so when they called me, it knocked me right off the Periscope. But instead of coming back on to do one, I just decided I'll come home and then I can do one without getting interrupted. And this is kind of along the line, the same one I was doing before. It's kind of a continuation. And I'll keep that on my news feed. But the one from last night, I deleted. But anyway, hi. I just thought I'd come home and do a Periscope where I won't get interrupted. Like I said, PetSmart called me and said the dogs were done. That's what cut me off. And I wasn't going to come back on for 20 minutes while they got ready. I thought I'd just pick them up and come home, and then I'd do one. So I'm going to... Happy New Year to you, too. So before I start, let me pray to your Father in Heaven. I pray that you be with me during this Periscope, that no technical difficulties will arise, and that those that are in here, Lord, will have an open mind and be attentive to what they hear, so that they can study it for themselves and realize what's coming upon this earth, and they won't be caught unawares, and they won't take the mark of the beast. I pray that you be with me and help me to give the message in love and help others understand what's coming so that they can be ready and I can be ready as well. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, as you know, the title of the scope is "Mark, Get Ready for the Time of Trouble." We all know, hi, Dolores. I got cut off before. The PetSmart called, my dogs were ready, so that cut me right off. So I didn't want to come back on until I got home. And I didn't change my, I never changed my clothes or anything. I just kept them right on. I've got to change later. But anyway, I kind of want to continue on with what I was talking about before. Well, we all know that the National Sunday Law is coming, and those that worship on Sunday will take the mark of the beast if they don't get out of those Sunday-keeping churches. And that's kind of along what I was saying before, you know, until I got interrupted with the phone call. But anyway, I encourage anybody in here that's going to church on Sunday to please come out of those Sunday-keeping churches. Yes, it's coming very, very soon. You're right. We don't know exactly when, but it's coming so soon. And, you know, I've been an Adventist over 40 years, and it's a lot sooner than it was when I first became a Seventh-day Adventist. That's for sure. I can see things happening over and over. Hi. Happy New Year. Good to see you. I mean, things are just getting closer and closer. Things are happening so fast that it really boggles the mind, you know, how fast things are moving. That, you know, if we're not ready for it, it's going to be here and boom, we're going to be stuck. So we need to be prepared. I got to get me something to drink here. This time I won't knock it on the floor. Anyway, I encourage anybody, if you got family members that go to church on Sunday, try to give them Bible studies and try to talk to them the best you can, because so many people, including my family members, which I don't have any family members alive now that worshiped on Sunday, and if I'd only known this when they were alive, I could have told them you shouldn't be worshiping on Sunday. But it just, you know, just happened that they were never told. Well, hopefully that they'll be up in heaven, you know. They'll see him in heaven when Jesus comes. That's the only thing we can hope for right now. You know, the saddest part of the whole thing is the time of trouble comes and our loved ones are amongst those that are going to be lost. That's terrible. We know that things are, the signs of the times are all around us. But things are going to get worse and worse. They're never going to get better. We know that. And we have to deal with it. You know, I hate when I hear things like that. Now, I don't listen to the news, and the reason I don't is because it's so morbid anyway, and it's always about death and destruction and things like that. There's nothing good on the news anymore. So that's kind of why I don't listen to the news. But, yes, we have hope of eternal life if we just grab onto it. And the problem of it is not enough people are grabbing onto it. We know there's going to be an awful lot of people lost. And you know, and I've read somewhere, and I don't know if it was Ellen White that had said that the wicked people are going to encompass the whole earth at the end times, just before it's destroyed by hellfire. Can you imagine how many people that really is? You know, and New Jerusalem is big enough for the whole world to fit inside, but people just aren't willing to accept what they hear. And that is so sad. You know, and a lot of them are not being told the truth anyway, you know, and they go through the life. Don't start that stuff again. If you start that stuff, you're going to be blocked, because I do not want that. I'm going to block you right now. And the thing of it is, they're not told anything. That's right. We love him by showing him. We show him by keeping his Ten Commandments, because he said John 14:15 says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." You know, and I can tell that verse to a lot of the Sunday keeping people. Hi, Happy New Year, but they don't want to accept it. And welcome to the Periscope. They really don't want to accept it because they're so settled in their fact that they're going to church on Sunday that it's so hard for a lot of people to change. You know. I thought it would be hard for me to change, too. I wasn't intending to change when I first went to the evangelistic meetings. But, you know, the message was so powerful. The meetings were so powerful. The word was so powerful that I had nothing to do but accept it. I just couldn't turn my back on, you know. And I'm so glad that I did accept it, because I now want to tell other people what I learned. You know, and we should all be willing to tell people what we learned. And like I said, talking about prophecy, thank you, Dolores. I just came back from PetSmart, and I wore what I usually wear to church. I've got a long skirt on and this top, and I just haven't changed them. I was going to put sweatpants on around the house, but I thought, well, I might as well do a Periscope with this on. And, great. I'm glad they did. You know, a lot of more people, if they'd ask for Bible studies, I think they'd really help. Well, you know, the one person that I follow on YouTube, I subscribe to, Bible Flock Box, he was a Roman Catholic before he became a Seventh-day Adventist. And he became a Seventh-day Adventist in prison. But he studied the Bible on his own. And he really, you know, he knew that something was missing. And, you know, it's possible that people are going to come. We know that we're going to get people from other denominations into our church at the end. But we're also going to lose some, too. And, no, that's sad. You know, that's the way it's going to happen. Ellen White's predicted that there's going to be 90% of the Seventh-day Adventists lost. Now, when you stop and think, that's only 10% saved. That's not an awful lot. And we don't want to be amongst that 90% that are going to be lost, because we know there's a shaking going on. And we know it's going to happen more from within the church than from without. Those are the ones that are going to persecute us the most, are the ones within the church. And we just have to stay true to God, and we have to realize what's really happening. And we can't be shaken out. The thing of it is, those ones doing the trying to be, you know, the being shaken out, they apparently are not grounded in the faith enough. You know, they aren't firmly grounded. If you're not firmly grounded, you're going to be swayed and you're going to go the wrong way. And that's what I think is happening. He's going to be in Bakersfield, California. When is he going to be in Bakersfield, California? I know he's going to be. I have missed him so much lately. I hope he comes back on. I'm sorry to hear that your family is evil. You know, all you could do is pray for them. Yes, he is coming. Oh, February 3rd. Okay. Yes, Jesus is coming soon. All you have to do is pray for your family, because they are so lost unless they accept Jesus. And all you can do is keep praying for them. And don't give up. You know, there's a lady in our church that prayed for her husband for well over 60 years. He didn't accept Jesus until about a month or two before he passed away. And she was so happy when he did. Because she said now she can rest assured that he will be in heaven he'll be going to heaven when Jesus comes, because he accepted him at the right time. He was very, very stubborn, and the pastor kept going over and talking to him every so often, and he refused to accept anything. Pastor wasn't going to push him, but he was just going to keep on talking to him and keep visiting him. Finally, I guess that's terrible. You know, you're like me. You know, I've only got just a few members of my family that are even alive. My son, who lives 21 miles from me, he's a Seventh-day Adventist, and my grandchildren. But I got a daughter that lives in Missouri that's fallen away. And, you know, I have to pray for her a lot, too, because I don't want her lost. But unfortunately, it's going to happen unless she comes back to Jesus. You know, she understands the Sabbath and everything. It's just that she doesn't want to do it. You know, and we got to keep praying for our family members, because time is so very, very short. And they don't realize how short it really is. We do, we should know, but our family members don't. You know, my son is like my family too. He's the closest to me because he lives 21 miles from me, and we're very, very close. Yes, Mark of the Beast is Sunday worship. You're exactly right. You're the only STA. Yeah, I hear you there, Dolores. You know, when I was married, my husband and I were the only STAs until our children became baptized. But you know, we can't give up. And my ex-husband is still a Seventh-day Adventist. And my son and my daughter-in-law and the kids are all Seventh-day Adventists. And I'm thankful for that, you know. But we have to pray for those that aren't. You know, that's so sad. We got to pray about that, you know. And you know, don't, be upset at your family. They probably didn't know what they were doing, you know, and the thing of it is you have to pray for them and hopefully that they'll come around. It's sad, though, that they did that to you, you know, and it's, but you know, if you keep on praying for them, your family may come around. You just had to love them anyway, you know, and we know there's going to be problems with, that we're going to have family members turn against other family members. Mothers against daughters, daughters against mothers, mother-in-laws against daughter-in-laws, and so on, so forth, and so on. It's just said in the Bible. God said in the Bible what's going to happen, and I can see that's what's happening in your family. But you got to pray for them. You can't, and you can't go back to what they've done at all. You got to stay true, and you have to say, "Well, I'm going to stand no matter what." Your family, you know. And the thing of it is, if your family's lost, it's going to be sad. But at least you'll be alive. You know, you'll be saved. But we all have to pray for our families. There's many family members that I don't know, the ones that are passed on, if they're going to make it or not, you know. And the only, like I said, the only family members that are left are my son and my daughter and the grandkids. Those are the only ones left that are alive. Oh, I'm sad. I feel for you. Let's pray for you right now. Dear Father in Heaven, you see one on this periscope that's having a lot of problems with the family. They've all turned against her and she's trapped living with them. And she doesn't know what to do. I just pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will convict her family's heart, that they will turn to you instead of turning away from you, and that she or he will draw closer to you more than ever and stay true to you in all circumstances, no matter what. Draw them close to you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You're so welcome. You know, I'm willing to do that because we need to pray for each other. We all need prayer, you know. And I'd be the first one to say, I need a lot of prayer. You know, and people that say they don't need prayer, well, they're mistaken. We all need prayer. You know, in Jesus' name, amen. We all need to come. We all fall short of the glory of God. Believe me, I do. Many, many times I fall short of the glory of God. But I'm here to say that I'm a testimony that God has delivered me from things that I wouldn't have thought ever possible. You know, and I'm a living testimony. You don't want to be homeless. You're just going to have to stay with it and just keep praying for them, you know. And that's right. Pray without ceasing. Yes, it is. 666 is the mark of the beast. Exactly. Yes, it is. It's the number of the beast. Exactly. And we know that the Antichrist is the Pope. And we know that time is coming very, very shortly. And I'm here to warn people that if you're not prepared for it and you're not ready for it and you're in those Sunday keeping churches, you'll take the mark without even realize it. You're right. You're right. And it's terrible that your family is so cruel to you. But it does show you that the time is very, very short. But like I said, just continue to pray for your family. It's got to be a heart-rending thing for you to be close to them and be in their family like that. You know, they can claim to be Christian, but just because they put that name on their title, or that title on them, doesn't mean they are. They have to live it. And if they can't live it, then they're not Christians. But you have to show your true faith in how much Christian you are. You know something? That's right. Sunday is the mark of the beast. By you showing that you still care, you still love them, no matter what, they will come around eventually. Because you love them, in spite of what they're doing to you. I know it's going to be hard. Oh, you gave your life helping them? Well, that God bless you, and thank you for doing so. You did the right thing, you know. And it's very, very hard to deal with things like that. But you know, we know things are going to happen. I'm just hoping that my family doesn't turn against me. But it can happen. You know, my daughter can eventually turn against me, and I'll have to accept it. There'll be no swimming in the lake of fire. Believe me, when the hellfire comes, you're going to be screaming and writhing in pain. There will be no swimming. You'll be screaming and want to die as quick as you can. Some are going to die quicker than others. And we know that Satan's going to be burning the longest. Yeah, they're going to burn right up. You know, you're sick and they ignore it. Well, like I said, just keep praying for them, you know, and send up a silent prayer to God. He'll help you. It's got to be a terrible time for you, I know. You're welcome, you know. And anytime you need any more prayer, just come in and I'll be more than happy to pray for you because, you know, like I said, we all need prayer. And in the situation you're going through, nobody should have to go through that. But, you know, that goes to show you how fast things are going, you know. And, well, yes, it's not going on yet, but it will be real at the time. There is no hell right now. I know that a lot of preachers will say you either go to hell, heaven or hell when you die. But, you know, that hell isn't going on yet. It's not until after the 1,000 years of peace, the hellfire comes down. God rains fire down from earth, from heaven, and and destroys the world with hellfire. Yeah, prayers is all we can do, you know. We have to pray for each other. Pray without ceasing, like they said, you know. And keep our, you got to keep your chin up. I know it's going to be difficult, but you can't waver. God's there for you, you know. And Satan, on the other hand, he's going to try to destroy you too. But you can't let that happen. Because he knows the situation you're going through. And he's going to try to take you down. Jesus is not black. He was Jewish. You don't see anywhere that Jesus was black. It never said in the Bible he was black. And it's immaterial if he was or not. No, hell does not exist. It doesn't exist, but it will exist after 1,000 years of peace. And it will, and their hellfire will be coming down from heaven. And everybody's going to be destroyed. It goes to hellfire. All the wicked, Satan and his angels. Satan is going to burn the longest because he's got to burn for all the sins of the whole entire world. Jesus was not Arab. He was Jewish. I don't know where you're coming off saying he was Arab. He was a Jew. So don't come in here and saying things that you don't know. Oh, you know, I'd love to see Satan burn too. And we know we're gonna walk on their ashes. And you know, what the saddest part of it is, what happens when you die? That's a good question. When you die, you go into your grave awaiting one of the two resurrections, either the first resurrection, which is the resurrection of the righteous, or the second resurrection of the wicked, which is after the 1,000 years of peace. And you don't want to be amongst the wicked. The thing of it is, you go to sleep in your grave is exactly what she said. You do not go to heaven or hell when you die. I know a lot of preachers will preach everybody into heaven most of the time. I've never heard them preaching them into hell, but they'll preach them into heaven when they die. And you know, that's the very lie that they're believing that Satan told in the Garden of Eden. If you recall, after Satan fell from heaven, he came down to earth. He showed himself as a snake in the garden. It was in the tree. Adam and Eve had got separated. She left Adam's side, but God told them they could eat of every tree of the garden except the one, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If they ate from it or even touched it, they would die. Well, Satan knew what God had said, and when he tempted Adam and Eve to sin, he asked him the very question, did God say that you were going to die? And they said, yes. Well, you're not going to die. You're going to live forever. That's where the immortality of the soul came in. None of us have immortality of the soul. We're not going to have immortality of the soul until Jesus comes back and our vile bodies are changed. We're going to have perfect bodies then because these bodies are so racked with sin now. Anybody that wears glasses will never wear glasses again. You know, and I've had back pains. When Jesus comes, my body will be changed and I'll never have another back pain again. Praise the Lord. Because sometimes it can be excruciating, you know. And I won't have gray hair anymore. That's amazing. I won't be old. You know, we won't grow. We'll grow up as calves of the stall, but we won't be old. And I just can't imagine myself being young. You know, the only way I can imagine myself being young is look at my pictures when I was young. But I just can't remember my childhood too much, you know. So to be young again, that'll be wonderful, you know. And be able to leap like the rabbits and things like that. Because, you know, I can't run right now at all. You know, I've tried as I might, and I fall over myself and everything. But I'll be able to leap, you know, and run as fast as I can, you know. And guess what? Playing harp, too. We've got a gal in our church that plays the harp beautifully. And when she was playing it last Sabbath, I thought, oh, my goodness, we're going to be able to play the harp like that someday. I've never been able to play the harp at all. But we get up in heaven, we're all going to have harps, and we'll be able to play them beautifully. Can you imagine on Sabbath morning, we'll all be playing the harps together, making beautiful music? Oh, I can hardly wait. I hope you can't wait either, because I'm just so looking forward to it. And you know, things are coming so very, very close now. We know that time's getting short. Things are happening around us so fast that it just boggles the mind. You know, one thing after another. You get one. Oh, you know, you see the news on one thing, which I don't watch the news, but I get it from other people, or see it on the internet. Get through one thing, and then there's something else pops up, you know, and it's, you just can't get away from all this bad news, you know. But the thing, yeah, that's right. It doesn't matter what color Jesus was. And for that person to come in here and keep saying, I'm going to block you if you don't stop it. He was not black. We tried to tell you what he was. He's not black. And if you keep saying so, you're blaspheming the Holy Spirit and you're going to be blocked and you'll never come back again. You don't need to troll in here. It doesn't matter what color Jesus was. As long as you love him and you're going to be saved, you go to heaven, you'll be with him. It don't bring his color into this. That has nothing to do with it. I don't like it when people come in here and talk bad about Jesus, because you really don't know. You're just trying to make things up as you go. Get into the Word of God and look for yourself. That's right. Listen to the message, because what you're doing is you're trying to distract people from hearing the message that I'm presenting, and you can't do that, because this message is so very important for the days that we're in. Like I said, we're going to... Okay, he's gone. This is it. I'm not dealing with no more. That's gone. You won't have to deal with him. Okay. That people think that Sunday is the true worship day because they've been doing it for so long. They're steeped in tradition, like the Bible says. In vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. They're steeped in their tradition of thinking that Sunday is the Sabbath because they don't know any better. And you know, that's the sad thing about the Catholic people. They're honest, sincere people, but they're so deceived because they have never been told the truth. And until they're told the truth, until they come into my Periscope or one of these other ones and we're told the truth, they're never going to know. So I don't want them lost either. I don't want anybody lost. But unfortunately, not everybody's going to yield and accept everything they hear. And we know that. It's a given, you know. No, you don't. You do not. When you die, you go to your grave and you sleep in Jesus until one of the two resurrections. At least we hope you sleep in Jesus. You either get resurrected when Jesus comes, or you'll lay in your grave until the 1,000 years of peace are over, and then you'll be resurrected only to be killed in the lake of fire. So, no, they're not. No, they're not true believers. Exactly. No, they're the head of. They're the what you call the secret society in the Catholic Church, and they're ahead of a lot of things, you know. And they brought a lot of things onto this world. No, you don't want to trust. Put your faith and trust in Catholic. A lot of people think that they are what they call the Mother Church, and everybody is following them by going to church on Sunday. You're new to church history. You know, there's a lot to be studied up on church history, but you know, a lot of people don't. All these other churches are following the Catholic Church. They're supposed to be protesting, but because they go to church on Sunday and they follow the Catholic Church with their false doctrines and everything, they're not really protesting anything. They're following the Catholics to a T with all their false doctrines, the Sunday worship and everything. That's right. You know, we're exactly going to know. It's imperative now exactly what he looks like. We just have to be ready for his coming. The King James Version is the best. Now, I have both the King James Version and the New King James. There is a little variation in the New King James from the King James, but not that much. But the King James Version is the original. So that's the one I really recommend. I do take the New King James and use it in Sabbath school, however. You know, but I do have the King James Version hard copy, and I also have the King James Version on my cell phone. So, yeah, stay away from the NIV. There's a gal in my Sabbath school that has the NIV, and she reads out of it every Sabbath. And I want to tell her so bad that she shouldn't be reading the King James Version, or she should be reading the NIV. My son says, Mom, don't say anything to her, because there's so many passages missing and things like that. But evidently she does it because it's easier for her to read. Now, I don't know which version her husband has, but he doesn't have the NIV at all. He may have the King James or the New King James, but he doesn't have the NIV, you know. Yeah, it does take... Yeah, I think there's 60 different passages that have been cut out from the Bible. And it's twisted, all right. You know, and I've never owned an NIV. And when I found out what the NIV entails, I don't want anything to do with it. Because you're not getting the whole Bible. Why they would take out 60 different passages, I have no idea. And I don't know what those passages are, but they're throughout the Bible, I guess. So, I suppose they did. They changed the language, you know. And, there's 60 passages been removed from the Bible. And, you're so welcome. I'll answer anything I can, as long as the comments don't come so fast that I can't answer your questions. I'll be more than happy to. Yeah, when I heard that was 60, I thought, my goodness, that is an awful lot of passages to be taken out of that NIV. And I want to tell her so bad, but my son said, Mom, don't say anything to her. You know, because I don't want to discourage her from bringing the Bible at all, or discourage her from coming at all, you know. Well, they were translators and stuff that translated from Hebrew and Greek, and you had to know Hebrew and Greek in order to translate it. So, you know, it was all inspired by God, but these men that wrote it translated it into our modern day English. You know, I didn't know that. But that's kind of nice. No, you know you can't trust translators. That's true. But really, nothing has been lost in the translation. If you read your Bible, it's precise. Everything in there is true. You know, and because God is in the Bible from the beginning of Genesis to the end of Revelation, and we just have to get in our Bible and study it for ourselves and see what God has to say. Yes, you're right. We can't add to or take away. And the thing of it is, the NIV, they've done that very thing. They've taken it away. And it's so sad. Well, you know, I don't understand Hebrew. That's why I don't have the Hebrew, because I don't understand it. I don't understand Greek either. Please don't swear in this Periscope. I appreciate it very much. Thank you. You know, I just know English, and sometimes that can be hard enough to understand as it is without trying to understand Hebrew and Greek. No, they didn't. They didn't put together the original Bible. Not at all. Not at all. You know, as I understand it, the Catholics, I think, have a Douay Bible. That's what they have. They have their own special Bible. And from what I understand, now I may be wrong, but from what I've heard, the people in the congregation are not allowed to read the King James Version. Because I know their Douay Bible is so messed up. And that's probably why. They just have to follow that Bible. But you know, when you look in their Douay Bible, the Ten Commandments is the first thing that you would see that's wrong. Because they took out the second one because of the images. Because they don't, you know, they have images throughout the church. They took that one out. Oh my goodness, 421, wow. I didn't know that. I knew that was the Douay Bible. Anyway, on the Ten Commandments alone, they took out the second commandment. And since they took that one out, then our fourth commandment that God wrote became the third, and they shortened it, and then they took the last, the Ten Commandment, and they cut it into two. So they've changed the Ten Commandments, which they had no right to do, because God set the Ten Commandments in stone. They can't be changed, but yet the Catholics thought they could change it. And so they thought, well, we can change the Sabbath too, and we'll make it Sunday, and everybody will honor us. Well, that's what everybody's doing. Well, I studied up enough about the Catholic Church, seen enough videos about them and things like that, you know, to know what's going on in the Catholic Church. There's a lot of evil going on in the Catholic Church, and it's unfortunate, but it's true. And so many people don't understand what's happening in their own church, you know. Well, I've been watching other Periscopes and stuff, and like I said, I've seen a lot of YouTube videos on the Catholic Church, so I've gotten a little knowledge that way of understanding what's happening in the Catholic Church. There's a lot of false doctrine. Well, hi, Phil. Good to see you. Happy New Year. I'm glad you're here. Good to see you. I did a Periscope earlier, and I saved it so you can watch it, but I got knocked off because I got a phone call, but I decided to come home and do another one. Yeah, Happy New Year's to you, too. I'm glad you finally made it home from Fiji safely. Anyway, a lot of people don't, the Catholics just don't understand that they're going to church on Sunday. Yes, they do, but they have it after sundown on Saturday night, which makes it Sunday morning. You're welcome. You're welcome, Phil. They have it on, which actually from sundown to sundown is how our days go, not midnight to midnight. So when they have it after the sun goes down, that's actually Sunday morning. So they're actually having Mass considering Sunday. So they say, well, we have Mass on Saturday. But yeah, they do. But it's not the Sabbath, during the Sabbath hours. You're exactly right. The Jesuits control everything in the Catholic Church. And well, see, there's sundown. That's way past sundown. And they're not honoring the Sabbath at all. They're going to church on Sunday, and they're having a Mass on Saturday night. And the thing of it is, another thing that's so wrong, and I don't want to stomp on any toes, and I don't want to get anybody upset with me, but I'm here to tell the Catholic Church that when they go to that confessional and they ask the priest to forgive their sins, they shouldn't do that, because he is just a man. He cannot forgive their sins. God is the only one that can forgive sins. And yet he will go into that confessional with those people on the other side, a door, curtain, or whatever, and they'll tell them their innermost thoughts. And then he says, well, I forgive you. Where has he got the right to forgive them? That's right, only God can forgive sins. And another thing, they'll go to Mary too. See, they have all these images of Mary in their church, and that's why they don't accept the second commandment. They threw it out. Because they'll go to Mary, and they'll ask Mary to intercede for them with Jesus and forgive their sins. She can't do anything either. She's not in heaven. She's in her grave awaiting the resurrection. But you can't tell them that. Yeah, you're right. Everything is so corrupt. No, he's not. That's right. Yeah, and we're not to have grave. Yeah, and they took that Sabbath commandment out. We're about graven images because they have so many images in their church. And, you know, and that's the thing. People do bow down to them. And, you know, when I was a Lutheran, in a Lutheran church, right above the altar, there was a statue of Jesus. And I didn't know that that was really an image, but, we didn't worship it or anything. And it was a beautiful statue, but it's an idol. And it shouldn't have been there, you know. So all these Protestant churches have things in their churches they shouldn't have idols or anything like that. The only thing in our church that we have on the wall is the three angels, and those aren't idols because they represent the three angels that go out into the world and give the three angels messages of Revelation 14, 6 to 12. And that's the only thing we have. Yes, you're right. Excuse me, I could drink. You're so right, you know. And I'm glad I came out of that Lutheran church. I was from the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. I was born and raised in the Lutheran church. And when I went to those Seventh-day Adventist evangelist meetings, I didn't know what to expect. And they're, you know, they're all clasping hands with the Catholic Church. As you could say, and I've heard it so many times in a YouTube video, and it makes a lot of sense, that they're in bed with the Catholic Church. That's exactly what they are. All of these Protestant churches, with the exception of the Adventists, are in bed with the Catholic Church because they go along with everything they have to say. All their false doctrines, the immortality of the soul, the rapture of the church, the fact that you burn forever and ever, which you don't. They have all of that, and it's so sad. And they need to come out of the Bible says you need to come out of Babylon. It's nothing but confusion. That's exactly what they are. They're confusing everybody, you know. And people don't need to be confused. And there's enough confusion in the world, too, without going to church on Sunday and being more darn confused than ever, you know. And that's why I come in here, because I want people to understand that, hi, good to see you. Happy New Year. And to let people know that as long as you continue to go to church on Sunday, when that enforced national Sunday law comes, you'll take the mark of the beast without expecting to, because you're expecting it to be a chip. A lot of people are expecting it to be a chip. And they say, well, I'm not going to be chipped. But that's true. You're supposed to honor God every day, but you can't keep holy every day. You can only keep holy the Sabbath, which is the seventh day. That's the only day you can keep holy. And people like to say, well, I can keep every day holy. But you can't. Yes, he is. He is God. Very much so. You know, and people like to say they keep every day holy, but you can't keep every day holy. God says you can only keep holy the seventh day. You can't keep holy what God never made holy. Try as you might, you just can't do it, you know. And the thing of it is, we cannot keep the Sabbath or any of the other commandments on our own power. We cannot. Everything that we do has to come from God. He has to give us strength to do this. We can't. I can't keep the commandments on my own. I can't come in here and do what I'm doing on my own without God's strength and to give me the words to say. Because, you know, I'm not articulate in speech at all, you know. And I do stumble a few times. But I know God is blessing me for what I'm telling you, because I'm giving you the truth. And as hard as it is to accept sometimes, I have to do it, because it is imperative, because time is so short. And we know that Ellen White said the final movements will be rapid ones. And I do believe that's very, very true. And the thing of it is, we have to stay true, because there's coming a day when the Holy Spirit is going to be withdrawn completely. It's slowly being withdrawn from the earth now. And when that time of trouble comes, we're not going to have the Holy Spirit to fall back on. We're going to have to fend for ourselves. What are we going to do then? Are we going to stand for what we know to be true, or are we going to yield? We cannot yield at all, you know. And that's going to be hard to go without the Holy Spirit here, but God has to do that. Yes, I do believe that it was God's, in God's plan that Trump get it. We only have to wait and see what's going to happen. He's going to be inaugurated in 19 days, and we'll have to see what kind of a person he's going to be as president. We really don't know. Yes, that's true. He does. He does reveal a lot. Well, the problem of it is, God is in control, but so is the devil. The devil is more in control than you think. The devil is the deceiver, and he's got so many people deceived thinking that what they're doing is right, and they don't know. They don't know they're being deceived by the devil, and that's so sad. And I wish that people would get into their Bibles and start reading it more and understanding that the devil is taking people down where they don't want to go and having them do things they shouldn't want to do. Or that's right. That's right. We've got to prepare because we know that time is so short. And you weren't in my Periscope the other night, Phil, when I was talking about what the devil tried to kill me one night. I was eating my supper and I started choking. And I knew I was eating it properly, but he made it go down the wrong way, and I started choking. Well, I know usually water will help, you know, satisfy it, and I feel pretty good, and I can go. But I lost my voice completely. The water did not help. Hi, happy New Year, and welcome to Periscope. Water did not help, so I got up, and I went into the kitchen, got some juice. That helped a little bit. But, you know, I was burning so bad in the chest because I was choking. I was trying to get it out, and I couldn't get it out, and it burnt so bad. And I said, Lord, help me. And you know, he did. I finally got it out. But I knew that it was the devil trying to kill me because he knew I was going to come on Periscope that night. He knew what I was going to talk about. And I did talk about it. And he didn't like it. Yes, he does. He tries to steal, kill, and destroy. And he was trying to take my life. And I knew it was the devil. It wasn't anybody else. And I am just so thankful that the Lord intervened and he wasn't able to get his way. And I'm here to give you more Periscopes, because that'd have been awful. You know, you'd have missed me, and I'd have missed doing them too, you know. But I'm so thankful that the Lord took control, and he will take control. I don't know anything about the Jedi. That has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. And yeah, Satan can't defeat anybody, you know. The thing of it is, Satan is a great deceiver, and he's out to steal, kill, and destroy, and he's trying to destroy anybody he can. I'm discussing about the time of trouble that's coming upon us, and yes, Michael is Jesus the archangel. I am glad I was okay too, Dolores, because it was scary for a while, because I wasn't sure I was going to get my voice back in order to be able to do a Periscope that night or not, because it was really bad. And I mean, when my chest was on, I felt like my chest was on fire, and I thought, oh my goodness, you know, and that, you know, that's, I know they're going to disrespect it. They already are, and they can disrespect it all they want, but I'm telling the truth. I'm telling you what God has said. I'm telling you what the Bible has said. It's not what I said, and I don't take any glory in any of this. I give the Holy Spirit all the glory. I don't take any of it. I'm just God's instrument. I'm his mouthpiece. I'm telling you what is coming upon this earth. It's a warning. And the thing of it is, it's hard for some people to believe because they want to say it's fairy tales, but it's not fairy tales. It is very true. And all I can say is the ones that are calling it fairy tales or scoffing at it won't be scoffing much longer because it's black and gray. I've got a black skirt on with a top that's black and gray. And the thing of it is, people just don't understand. You know, they think that what they're doing is right, but they're not. Don't tell me what I need to do. That's disgusting. That's gone. Oh my goodness. God is a spirit. God has existed from the very beginning. Yeah. He doesn't believe in God. You're right. Well, hi, happy New Year to any of those coming in. Yeah, I did. I blocked him. And anybody that I don't catch, block them for me. I catch the ones that I can. Yes, the devil is real, unfortunately. And he's out to destroy the world and not to destroy us as much as he can. Like I said, God is up in heaven. That's where he's at. And it's a capital G-O-D, not a lowercase G-O-D. He's capital G-O-D. He's up in heaven. And who created God? God, he was here from the very beginning. Nobody created him. He was here from the very beginning. How do you think the world was made? It was made by God. He set everything up into space. he set the stars up in space, the sun, the moon, the sky, and it was miraculous what he did. That's, and God is the big G. The little G's are the false gods that some of these people worship. You know, the false idols and images and things like that. But if you don't believe in God, I'm here to tell you, look around you. Look into nature. Look at the sun, the stars, the moon, the sky, the clouds, the trees. Where do you think they all came from? They came from God. He put them up there, and it was a miracle that he did. It was miraculous when he put them up there. Well, you can be an atheist and you don't disrespect me. You say I'm ignorant. That's because you don't know. I do believe in the Trinity. Yes, I do. I'd rather call it Godhead, but that's neither here nor there. But the one that says they're atheist and it's ignorant, you know, you call it ignorant because you do not know the truth. And you will feel that way. I know other people are going to come in here too and say that I'm all ignorant, you know, and what I'm saying is not true. That's because you have never heard it before. And when you've never heard it, you're going to be a skeptical about it. But my advice to you is to get into the Word of God and see if I'm telling the truth or not. It doesn't benefit me one bit to lie to you because it affects my salvation if I lie. But it affects your salvation when I tell the truth and you know it and you heed it. It benefits you as well. So you can, Jesus was much more than a prophet. He was human as well as divine. And you sounds like a Jehovah's Witness because that's what they believe, that Jesus was just a prophet and he was nothing more. He was human as well as divine. And he did many wonderful things on this earth. He raised people from the dead. You know, he raised Lazarus from the dead. He performed many miracles and healed people too. And I still believe in healing to this day, that God performs miracles. You just have to accept it and believe it and pray to him. If you have a problem in your life like sin or you have a you have an illness or something, just ask God to help take the illness away. That's right. He was the Son of God. Just ask God to help you with that illness that you have. And he will, you know, he's all knowing. He's everywhere. He knows what's going on. He knows, he sees the end from the beginning. He knows who of us are going to be saved and who isn't. Those disrespecting are ignorant. You know why? It's because they don't understand. They've never been told. And that's the sad thing of it. And that's why I come in here, because I know there's people that haven't heard. And they need to hear, though. You know, that's right. You can't. To live as Christ, you're not, and to die is gain. If you live without Christ, you're nothing. You have nothing. And, you know, and I couldn't go through this life not having Christ, because I wouldn't be the same person. You know, God is with me at all times. Not all religions are a sham, and you may think that, because you're probably not religious and don't go to church or anything like that. They're not a sham. But all I can tell you is, get a Bible. They're real cheap. Go to stores and pick up a Bible and start reading it. Believe me, once you get into the Word of God, you're not going to be putting it down. You know, I get into the Word of God every day, which reminds me, I haven't done it yet today, but I will do it later. You know, you get into the Word of God every day. You don't want to put it down because there's so much knowledge there. And so much. And you learn every time you read the Bible. There may be something that you may have missed the first time you read it. The second time you'll see something that you missed and, oh, well, I didn't realize that was there. I'm finding that very true. Who cares? Don't bring that into this periscope. I don't care what you've done after reading the Bible. Don't put that in here. That's disrespectful. You know, but you find, you learn from reading the Word of God. And if you can't discern, the Holy Spirit will help you discern, you know, because I know there's many things in the Bible that are hard to understand. You know, when it comes to Daniel and it comes to Revelation, people don't want to read it. And I've heard a lot of pastors won't even get into those books of the Bible when they preach on Sunday morning because they don't want to scare their congregation. Well, they need to be shook out of their boots because they're sitting in their pews. They're all lukewarm. They don't know anything, and they need to get into the Word of God, and they need to stress what is coming so that their congregation is ready for it. And if the congregation leaves the church, so be it. At least it won't be on his hands. But as long as he doesn't tell them the truth, he's responsible for his flock. And he needs to tell him the truth. Allah is not real. It's a fake God. He never was real. It's just a God that somebody made up. It's the God of heaven that's real. And that's the one that I honor. That's who I'm going to heaven to be with. Not Allah or anything else or Muhammad or anything like that. And also, no, he is not. I will argue with you on that. He's not. Well, that's beautiful. You know, we do need to love each other. You're so true. And the thing of it is, people don't. There isn't as much love in the world as there should be. Even in our own churches, there's not as much love as there should be. Everybody should love one another. Give each other hugs on Sabbath morning, you know. And, you know, we have I think I've told some of you before, we have a guy in our church that dresses like a woman sometimes. I'm not sure if he's transgender or he's a cross-dresser. But, you know, yesterday I wished him a happy new year. He says, can I have a hug? And I says, you sure can. It felt a little odd hugging him. But, you know, I thought, well, that's what God would want me to do. I'm not going to turn my back on him. He's a human being, after all. He's just confused. He doesn't know what he's doing, you know. So, and I was glad to hug him, and I felt real good about it afterwards. Hi, happy new year. But, you know, things like that are going to happen in our churches. Our churches are getting very lax on things like that. God does not hate us. God loves the sinner, but he hates the sin. You won't find that anywhere in the Bible where God says he hates us. Don't use that word. Do not swear in this periscope, please. Keep a level head and be open-minded and be prepared to hear what you hear. And if you don't want to hear it and you think it's all what you call it, BS, then I would appreciate you leave, because I don't want to have to argue with us. Because what I'm telling you is the truth. And you know the thing of it is, you say that because you've never heard the truth. And just because I'm telling you and it's the truth and you think it's not the truth doesn't mean that I'm lying, because I'm not. It doesn't benefit me to lie at all. It's going down the tubes fast. Now we're in the first day of the year of 2017. We don't know what this year is going to bring. We know it's not going to probably be any better than 2016. We can hope, but we know things are going to get much, much worse before Jesus comes. But tell you what's going to happen. Well, right around the corner is the National Sunday Law, where it's going to be enforced Sunday worship, where everybody is going to be required to worship on Sunday. And if they don't worship on Sunday, they can't buy or sell. And that's why a lot of people are going to take the mark of the beast, because they feel they're going to starve. But God said our bread and water will be sure. We do not know. Well, you could call it rubbish now, and you can scoff now, but I'm afraid that when that time comes, you'll take the mark of the beast, because you don't believe. You don't want to accept it. You need to come in here and have an open mind. I wouldn't go into somebody else's periscope and do to them what you are doing to me. You need to come in here with an open mind and be prepared to listen and accept what you've heard, because it's not far-fetched at all. It's in the Bible. And if you don't want to accept it, it's on you. God gives you free will. And if you don't want to accept it, fine. But you'll have to pay for the consequences in the end. Well, you can say there is no God. Where do you think you came from? You didn't evolve. You were created. Where do you think the trees came from? God. The flowers came from God. The sun, the moon, the stars, the sky, they all came from God. So don't tell me there is no God, because I know he exists. I just happen to have my eyes like this. People know that I have my eyes open, but it just looks like that. So it just have to bear with me. So, but I'm trying to do the best I can. Yeah, that's right. If there's no God, where'd the animals come from? Where do you think you came from? You didn't evolve. You didn't hurt me. It's just that I get upset at people that can't accept the truth for what it is. You just don't want to understand the truth, and you come in here with a closed mind, and you think that I'm going to give you a watered-down gospel, and I'm going to tell you what you want to hear. You're going to have itching ears, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to tell you the truth, and if you don't like it, then you just have to leave. But I'm hoping that you'll stay long enough to hear the truth and accept it and understand that what I'm telling you is the truth, that you'll be prepared for what's coming, because this world is going downhill fast. And that enforced National Sunday Law is right around the corner. I do not know when it is coming, but it is very, very close. And the thing of it is, a lot of people are not willing to accept it. And I'm not a pastor. I'm just a lay person. I don't have to have credentials to come in here and do this. But I will tell you this. I have been encouraged by one pastor that I go into his periscope every night. Thank you. I have been encouraged by one pastor that's a pastor in Alabama. He's encouraged me to do these, and he told me to keep it up. And I intend to keep it up. And yes, people need to hear the truth. And I know it's very hard for me to tell the truth, and it's very hard for you to hear it. I know, because it sounds like it's so weird. But I have to do it. You know, it's not something that I want to do, but I have to do it. That's right. One day you're going to find out that Jesus does exist. One day you're going to find out there is a national Sunday law and that you're going to burn up in hellfire. But then it's going to be too late. You need to accept now. There's no time like the present. Don't put off till tomorrow what you can do today. And that's what a lot of people do. They want to put everything off and say, well, I'll just wait until the national Sunday law comes. And then oh, good. Thank you. You know, it's not me, though. I'm just God's instrument. I give him all the glory. I'm telling you what God wants me to tell you, and he gets all the glory for it. You know, I'm not going to turn to Allah. Allah is just a false god. It's Jesus who I'm talking about. Jesus is the one that's coming back, and he's coming back very, very soon. But he's coming back audibly, and he's coming back physically. People, people like to say that the Jesus is coming back secretly, but that is a false doctrine. That is brought in by the Catholic Church and the Jesuits again. There is no secret rapture for the simple fact that Revelation 1:7 says, every eye shall see him, even those that pierced him. He's coming back in the clouds. He's coming back with a shout and the sound of a trumpet. That's not secret. Everybody shall see him. Even the wicked are looking for Jesus to come, because they're going to cry for the rocks and the mountains to fall on him. They don't want to see his face. So that's how bad it's going to be for them people. Yes, pretty much. And if you don't want to hear about it, I'm sorry, but you don't have to come in here. You know what my Periscope is about. You saw the title. And the earth is not flat. Please don't bring that into my Periscope. That has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. Jesus made the earth. He made the world. The world is round. That's right. Jesus is real. Satan exists. He does exist. And people that don't accept him, that I'm sorry that you don't accept him, but he's very real. He will try to do everything he can to take your life. He's tried to take my life, and he's going to try to take more lives. And you got to be ready for whatever he's bringing upon this earth. What's going to happen on Judgment Day? Well, that depends on you. You know, each of us are going to be judged according to our works. That depends on you, what's going to happen on Judgment Day. I can't say, but all I can tell you is you better be ready for what's to come, because that's coming right around the corner. When that enforced National Sunday Law comes, are you going to take the seal of God, which is the Sabbath, or are you going to take the mark of the beast, which is the seal of Satan? Which are you going to do? Because once you take the mark of the beast, you're done. That's it. There's no more repenting for you. You can't turn your back and say, what's going to happen to atheists on Judgment Day? The same thing has happened to the wicked. They will not be saved because they haven't accepted Jesus. They more or less atheists, they believe in Satan. You can't say, well, you don't believe in anything. You either believe in God or you believe in the devil. It's one or the other. You can't, you know, so don't turn your back on God. If you accept God, accept him. And don't turn your back on him, because that's going to be your downfall if you do. And the thing of it is, we know there's an awful lot of people going to be lost. Yes, the devil is real, but he doesn't mark. Well, I'm sure he probably does. He probably tries to kill you more than once. You know, he's tried to kill me once, but thank goodness he didn't succeed. Now, I'm not saying he'll never try again, mind you. Because he's out to steal, kill, and destroy. Because I come in here and give the message. He doesn't want me to do that. So he's going to try to stop me as much as he can. Well, let him try. Because God is greater. You know what I say? And this is what I'm going to take with me from now on. And everybody should do the same thing. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And that is so true. God is in me. He's greater than Satan or anybody else for that matter. I don't put my faith and trust in any man. I don't put my faith and trust in Satan. I put my faith and trust in God. God is who I put my faith and trust in. We all should put our faith and trust in God. Satan is out here just to deceive us and to destroy us. He's doing as much as he can because he knows his time is short. He's got a very short time. And once he's in hellfire, that's it for him. But you know, during 1,000 years of peace, he's going to have all that time to reflect on what he's done to the people of this world and how many people that have gone down. You know, he's going to have to pay for the sins of the whole world, and it's going to give him a chance to reflect on all the sins that of everybody's sins. But you know, he's not going to be able to repent because he's not sorry for what he's done. That's the thing. No, it does not. Stop saying it is. I don't know what Bible you're reading from, but it's not my Bible. But, that's not true. No, the mark of the beast is Sunday worship. If you're going to church on Sunday, when the mark of the beast comes, you'll be taking the mark of the beast. That's right. The only way through heaven is Jesus Christ. But I'm here to tell you the truth. Do not take the mark of the beast, because you will be lost if you do. You got to come out of those Sunday-keeping churches. And no time like the present. Find a good Sabbath-keeping church. And if you don't want to go to a Sabbath-keeping church, you can find one online. Because it's very imperative. I'm here to tell the truth. I'm not here to lie to anybody or kid around, because this is not a joking matter. This is very, very serious. You're welcome. This is very, very serious. And I know a lot of people like to laugh about it, but it's nothing to laugh about. The thing of it is, they can laugh now, but they're not going to be laughing a whole lot longer. You know, and I don't want that to happen to anybody. You know, where they're going to get into hellfire and they're going to be screaming because it's going to hurt so bad. But that's what's going to happen. And the seven last plagues before that aren't even going to be any better. They're going to be screaming then too. We know that's going to come on the wicked too. So, yeah, that's right. He hangs the world to nothing. You know, it's a miracle that he hung everything up into space like he did. All the stars, all the clouds, the sun, the moon, the sky, hanging them up there like he did. You know, it's something that we'll never be able to wrap our minds around. You know, we get to heaven, we can ask him how he did it, you know. But until that time, we're just going to have to, you know, keep it to our imagination. But we know he did. Yes, God is alive. He's very much alive. And he's here on this earth. Or he's here in me. He's here with me. He's here every day, 24 hours a day. We have to stay true to God, too. We can't get into the things of the world. You know, we can be live in the world, but we shouldn't be part of it. Don't get yourself involved in things that do not matter and take your mind away from God, because that's what Satan is trying to do. He's trying to stir up trouble and trying to take everybody's mind away from God so that they'll forget about God. And we don't want to do that. When it comes to like video games and TV is another one. Bad things on TV, you know, and all these bad video games and things like that. The rap music, the music that's not Christian. Every bit of that can take our mind away from God. And what is really bad. You can call me nutty all you want. You just because you don't really understand what I'm saying. You know, that's okay. I've been called worse. But, you know, that's fine. You know, they call Jesus names too. But he never stopped preaching, and I'm not going to either. You can call me any name you want, but I'm never going to give up preaching. And maybe someday you'll see that I'm telling the truth. And I hope it's not too late when you do, that you'll get into the Word of God and understand that what I'm saying is in there. And that's right, we're nutty for Jesus. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's a good one. Nutty for Jesus. Exactly. 100%. You know, and we should all be nutty for Jesus, you know, and that's a good one. I never heard it put that way, but I like that. Hi, happy New Year. That was a real good one. That's a real good one. That's right. It's either Jesus or Satan. That's right. TV and radio and all this bad music corrupts the kids' minds. And, you know, a lot of teenagers are getting involved with all this music nowadays, you know, the rap music and video games. I've got a 21-year-old grandson that he's into nothing but video games. Well, my daughter, a lot of that's her to blame, because she got the kids started when they were real, real young on video games, and they've been on it ever since. Her two boys now, the youngest two, the 10 and 6-year-old, are in video games too. But, oh, it's the Mark of the Beast is coming, where we have what we call a National Sunday Law is going to be brought upon. It's an enforced National Sunday law, where everybody's going to be forced to worship on Sunday. And if you don't worship on Sunday, you can't buy or sell. But by worshiping on Sunday, when that time comes, you'll be taking the mark of the beast, and you'll automatically be lost. And once you've done that, you cannot turn around and change your mind and say that you want to start keeping the Sabbath, because it'll be too late. So well, some of the music is not fit to listen to. You got to be careful what you listen to. And because Satan is going to put things into your mind, you're welcome. Satan's going to put things into your mind that you wouldn't want there, and you got to know. You know, he's going to put bad things into your mind, and we got to keep those bad things out. That's why we have to keep our mind on God at all times. But yeah, subliminal messaging is right. Yeah. Why can't you? The ones that take the mark of the beast can buy or sell, but if we don't take the mark of the beast, which the Sabbath keepers won't do it, we won't be able to buy or sell, but we won't be taking the mark of the beast. We won't be lost, but we're going to have to die for our faith, possibly. We're going to be jailed. We're going to be martyred for our faith or whatever, you know. And we're going to be standing before them, and they're going to probably ask us to recant our faith in Jesus. We cannot do it, no matter what. We have to stay true. It's, you know, I know you may not believe it, but it's very, very true. It's still coming. It's coming on this world. And the thing of it is, if you don't want to believe it now, you'll be lost. I hope you can understand what I'm saying. Yes, it is. It has to do with Sunday worship. You're exactly right. Are you going to take the mark of the beast, or are you going to take the seal of God? The seal of God is the seventh day Sabbath, and that's the Sabbath from sundown Friday to sundown Saturday. That's the Sabbath, and that's the day that God has set aside as a day of rest to honor him. And the whole world right now is going to church on Sunday because they honor the resurrection. But there's nowhere in the Bible where it says you are to honor God's resurrection by going to church on Sunday. Well, no mark for me either. You have to die for your faith, but so be it. It's going to be a short period of time anyway. Yes, and it will happen again. There is a movie on YouTube. Now, I gave it to my son for Christmas. That I would like for you guys to watch is called A Lamp in the Dark. It had to do with the early ones that were martyred for their faith. It's a very good, it's almost 3 hours long, but I recommend that movie wholeheartedly on YouTube. And once you start watching it, you'll want to watch it again. This is not my day to go to church on. I went to church yesterday. This is not the Sabbath, I'm trying to tell you. This is the Sun God's day. You're worshiping Satan on this day. Yes, it's a lamp in the dark. Well, you won't be able to, we don't take the mark of the beast, we're not going to be able to buy food. But God said our bread and water will be sure. That's what he said. Our bread and water will be sure. He's going to provide for us. And those that take the mark of the beast, they'll be able to buy or sell. They'll be able to buy groceries and things like that. We won't be able to, there's going to come a time where we're not going to be able to worship on Sabbath either. We're going to be banned from worshiping on Sabbath. I'm just going to worship at home and you know, do what I can to still continue to worship anyway. God will provide for it. He said our bread and water would be sure. I rely on God. And that's what he said. He said our bread and water would be sure. That's the sad thing of it. That's why the people don't know what's coming on the world, because they don't understand. Because they have a relationship with Jesus, because they're not into the Bible. They don't understand what's coming on because they listen to their pastors. You should listen to no man. Don't trust any man, because they're gonna take you down. They're gonna lead you the wrong way. And men are liars. God is not a liar. The men are liars. And God is true. God said, God be true and every man a liar. And I don't want you to come in here and accept everything I say either without going into the Word of God, because I'm just God's mouthpiece. I'm his instrument. I want you to get into the Word of God and see if what I'm saying is true, because that's the only way you're going to know. I don't expect you to take my word wholeheartedly, but I have some that come in here and said that they've started studying the Bible and they're starting to go to church on Sabbath now because I've been giving these periscopes. But it's not me that's doing it. I gave the truth, but it was them that accepted it. The Holy Spirit tugged at their heart, and I give all the glory to God and the Holy Spirit. I do not take the glory for any of myself, and I can't do that, because that's wrong to do that. No, it's not all a sham. I know you may think it is because you've never heard this before, and that's understandable. That's why I do it. I know a lot of people have never heard this before, but just because you've never heard it before does not mean it's not true. You have to have an open mind and be willing to accept it. Get into the Bible and see what God's Word says. That's right. Sunday is for the Sun God. What if, hypothetically? There is no what if. You can say hypothetically, but there is. It's not a sham. You have to open your heart. You have to open your heart and open your mind. Because once you've heard the truth and you refuse to accept it, Then that's when it. Then God said, "There's no more sacrifice for sins," and you need to understand that you can't. You can't deny what you've heard. God is. Sabbath was set apart as God's day. It's His Sabbath. It's not mine. No, there's no sap God. He is God. Mark 2:27 said Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. God is the one that says Saturday is the seventh day. He's the one that made it the Sabbath. I didn't. So when I go to church on Sabbath, it's His Sabbath, not mine. But I keep it because I want to honor Him, because I love Him so much. And He said, if you love me, keep my commandments, John 14:15. Allah will not be there. There will be no Allah there. He's just a false god. God and Jesus are going to be there. Not no Allah, not no Muhammad or anything like that. That's right. They're pagan names. The names of the week were not in the Bible. You won't find them in there. They were given by pagans, you know. You can find the Sabbath for the word Saturday is Sabbath, and it's in many different languages. Like Sabado, Sabato. You go in the different foreign languages and see what Sabbath is. And you even go in the dictionary and look up the word Sabbath. And it'll tell you it's the seventh day of the week. So is the dictionary wrong? No, it's not wrong. Because I've looked it up. And that's exactly what it says. The seventh day is the Sabbath. And can't deny it. No, Zeus is not going to be up there. Those are all false gods. Stop believing in false gods. Because it's not true. Is God in heaven is the one I serve, not no false god, you know. And that's the problem. A lot of people come in here thinking they're now Sabbath Truth.org is another one, right? So and a lot of people need to look at these websites that are being posted up here and get into them and read them. You learn a lot from them. He is real. Where do you think you came from? Look around you. Look out and see the clouds. Look at the trees in your yard. Where do you think they came from? God put them there. Man didn't put them there. God did. You can't. And He made everything like that. That's right. Blessed are those that have not seen but have heard. You know, I've never seen God, but I know He exists. So that's why I believe. You see, He's throughout the Bible, from the book of Genesis to book of Revelation. He's in the Bible. And that's why I believe. Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. He told them exactly what to say. They put down in the Bible what He told them to say. But the only thing that men did not write was the Ten Commandments. God wrote those with His own finger because He didn't trust anybody else to write them. So, and they've never been done away with, and they're never going to be done away with because they're going to be keeping the Sabbath in heaven. So why not start now? Because it's not impossible. If you start keeping it now, it'll be real easy to keep it in heaven. Be very easy. You know, oh, I'm glad you do. You believe in God. You know, the best thing to do is get into your Bible and start reading and look up some of these Bible, the websites that people are posting in here to help you too. That's right. We got to confess and believe with our heart that Jesus is, you know, if you don't, you're going to be lost because the Bible says to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. But it takes more than just belief. That's right. He is real. But you know, it takes more than just belief. We have to be obedient as well. You know, there's a lot to, you know, we have to be obedient. And by going to church on Sunday, that's not being obedient because He never instituted Sunday as the Sabbath at all. And yet look how many people are going to church on Sunday because they don't know the truth. Jesus is not a myth. You can say that He is. I know you're doing it hypothetically, but don't, you're going to confuse people in here by saying that. So He's not a myth. He's real. So don't put these hypothetical ones up here because I'm trying to tell people the truth. And I don't want you coming up here with these hypothetical questions because it's going to get people wondering. No, He's not a myth. He's very much real. He was born in a stable many, many years ago. He was born in a stable, born of Mary. Because see, she was conceived by the Holy Spirit and He came out of her womb. And so you can't say that He's a myth. So don't say that He's a myth because you're going to get people confused in here. I'm trying to tell the truth and help them understand. Then you got somebody in here come trying to say He was a myth. Hercules was a myth. Jesus is not Hercules. He has nothing to do with Hercules. So don't bring that into it. Jesus is real. And if you don't want to believe in Him, then you're going to suffer the consequences in the end. You can mock now and scoff and say that He doesn't exist. But you won't be scoffing a whole lot longer. Well, You can continue to believe it if you want to. I'm not going to block you because you need to hear the truth. I just pray that God opens up your eyes, that you'll start believing. Because if you don't start believing, you're going to be totally lost. And then you wish you had believed. And that's sad. You know, I get an awful lot of people in here that still don't understand what's going to happen on this world. Because they go into these Sunday-keeping churches and they're not told the truth because they're fed watered-down gospel. And they sit in their pews on Sunday morning. They're lukewarm. We're all lukewarm. If you go to church on Sunday, I think I saw what your question was. You can post it again because it went away before I had a chance to read it. But if you're going to church on Sunday during the National Sunday Law, you will be lost. You need to come out of those Sunday-keeping churches now. Do not get involved in Sunday-keeping churches because it's just you're just worshiping the sun god. You're not worshiping Jesus. You're worshiping the devil. And it's not the day that God instituted as the Sabbath. You want to keep God's Sabbath. Because if you love him, you'll want to do what he asks you to do. He did so much for me. Why can't we do the same thing for him, you know? The thing of it is, there's going to come a time when we may have to die for our faith for Jesus. But are we willing to do that? I hope so. Because he died for... what's the law called? It's called the Ten Commandments. It's in Exodus chapter 20. You can start reading the Ten Commandments. In Exodus 20 verses 8 to 11... is where it talks about the Sabbath commandment. And the very first word in that commandment is remember, because he knew that people would forget. And the thing of it is, the Ten Commandments were written by God. He wrote them with his own finger. We consider that the law. They're not opinions or anything like that. They're commands. When Jesus says something, he means it. Well, you can worship Jesus every day, but you cannot keep every day holy. Because you can only keep holy the Sabbath day, which was yesterday. You can't keep today holy. That's why I'm doing a periscope on this. I know people will come in here on Sunday and say they keep this day holy. You can't keep this day holy. I just came back from PetSmart getting my dogs groomed because it's not a holy day for me. Yesterday was a holy day. I kept yesterday holy. You know, didn't work or anything like that or go running around. But I can do it today because it's not a holy day. God never made it a holy day. And I'm here to tell you that you've got to come out of those Sunday-keeping churches. It's nothing but confusion. It's Babylon. And that's all it is. It's just Babylon. That's right. There are seducing spirits. We know that. And there's people going to say that Jesus is here and Jesus is there and stuff like that. No. That's wrong. That's blasphemy to say every day is a holy day. You're calling God a liar. He said only the seventh day is holy. You cannot keep every day holy. You can't make holy what he never said to make holy. And you're calling God a liar by saying every day is holy. It's not. If you're not working every day, then you're not doing what God said. You're supposed to work 6 days. Yes, I am. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. If you're not working 6 days and doing your normal activity on 6 days and going to church on the seventh, you're not doing what God asked you to do. That's right. People like to come in here and twist the scriptures. That's right. He's true and positive, but people like to come in here and say that every day is holy. That's calling God a liar because he only made one day holy. He only sanctified one day. He set it apart from the rest of the days, and that's the day we need to keep. We can't do what we want to do, and that's the thing. People come in here. That's right. Jacob's trouble is going to be right around the corner. Now, people think they can come in here and say anything and it's true, but it's not. You got to accept what's being put before you because I'm not lying to you. You can't keep every day holy. You can't twist God's word. You're trying to twist God's word to mean something it doesn't mean. You know, God said the seventh day is the Sabbath, and that's what you have to keep holy. Not every day of Sunday through Friday is not holy. Who cares if you did acid last night? None of us want to hear it. Keep that out of my periscope and listen to what's being said. And if you can't hear, listen to what's being said, then I prefer you leave. I'll pray for you, but you gotta have an open mind. You gotta be not say things that have nothing to do with this periscope. There's no difference. We are Christians. Seventh-day Adventists are Christians. We're Protestant Christians, but we're the only Protestant Christians out there because we're the only ones. Keeping Sabbath. Well, there are other churches that are starting to keep Sabbath now. There's Seventh-day Baptist, Seventh-day Church of God, and things like that. But the true Protestants are the only ones that keep Sabbath. The ones that keep Sunday are not true Protestants. Yes, they say they are, but they're not. They're following the Mother Church. They're doing everything the Catholics say not to do. In fact, if you ask a Catholic priest, he will tell you that Saturday is the Sabbath. But they said they changed the day. They had the on their authority. They changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. I love gay people, but I don't love what they do. God loves them too. He loves the sinner, but he hates the sin. That's right. We believe exactly what the Bible said. God says what he means, and he means what he says. If you're going to take the word of God and believe it, you got to believe it from Genesis to Revelation, not just in between, and keep what you want to keep and throw the rest of them out. And the thing of it is, a lot of people will come in here and they'll keep 9 of the commandments, but they won't keep the 4th one because they say it's not imperative for us today. Well, if you break one commandment, you're breaking them all. And that's what God said. If you ask the question if those one going on Sunday are lost, are going to take the mark of the beast, they will at that time. They're not yet because the mark of the beast isn't happening right now. But once it's been enforced, they will if they don't come out of the Sunday-keeping churches. That's right. Catholics change it. Like I said, any Catholic can go to their priest and ask him. He'll say, yes, Saturday is the Sabbath, but we instituted Sunday. You know, but they expect you to keep Sabbath. You know, they told you. Well, gay is being bad because you know what? God made Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. He loves the sinner, but he hates the sin. Being gay is a choice. It's not something that God instituted. He instituted a marriage between a man and a woman. He did not institute marriage between 2 women or 2 men or 3 men and 3 women or anything like that. So if you're gay, you need to come out of that lifestyle because you will not be saved either. And that, oh, hello from Russia, Happy New Year. Because no homosexual will inherit the kingdom of heaven. They won't be happy there. It doesn't matter if it says it's bad in Leviticus. It's bad. I'm telling you, it's bad. God, it's an abomination to God. And he did not, if God wanted us to be that way, he would have made us that way, but he did not. He wouldn't have made Adam and Eve if that's the way it was supposed to be. You've got to go by what the Bible says. I don't have to get off of Periscope. But if you don't want to be in here, then I'm going to make you get off of my Periscope. I'll make you, there you go. Bye. God made Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. And man created gay, not God. God didn't make any of us gay. The thing of it is, we didn't choose to be gay. And yet they say, well, we didn't choose to be that way. Why would we choose to be discriminated against? Well, you'll have to ask them. What's the trouble? It's the National Sunday Law that's coming on us, the Mark of the Beast. That's coming on us right around the corner where if you're going to church on Sunday, you will be taking the Mark of the Beast and you'll be lost. You will be able to buy and sell, but you will be lost. You'll be receiving the 7 last plagues, and you'll burn up in hellfire at the very end. So that's why I come in here. I don't want people to take that mark of the beast unknowingly. The National Sunday Law is right around the corner, and you need to find a good Sabbath keeping church. No, we don't have. We did have it yesterday. We have it every quarter. We don't have it every Sabbath. Yesterday, because it was the end of the year, we had communion last Sabbath. Normally, we have it in January, but they set it up yesterday. So I did have communion yesterday, where we have the foot washing and we drink the grape juice. Because we don't drink wine in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It's grape juice. But we're doing exactly what God asks us to do. You know, and those ones going to church on Sunday, you're not really doing what God asks you to do. You're staying in a church that is not biblical. There's nowhere in the Bible that says to go to church on Sunday because Jesus rose on that day. There's nothing in the Bible to that effect. And yet that's why people keep it, because they say, well, Jesus rose on that day. And that's why we go. I don't know about polyester. I have not known, but being gay is not good. No, you're right. Okay, I'll try to slow down. Okay, I'll try to talk a little slower. What is going to happen is there's going to be an enforced Sunday law put on this earth. It's going to start in the United States and it's going to go globally. What that means is everybody in the whole world is going to be required to worship on Sunday. And if you don't worship on Sunday, you won't be able to buy or sell, but you're not taking the mark of the beast either. Because once you take that mark of the beast, there is no turning back. you are automatically lost. You will suffer the seven last plagues and hellfire at the very end. And my thing is, it's very imperative that you heed this, because the Bible says, come out of her, my people, that you receive none of her plagues. It is all confusion. What if you don't worship at all? Well, that's between you and God. But you can't go to church on Sunday. But you need to believe in something. The thing of it is, if you don't worship at all, then you really don't believe in God. Then you believe in the devil. And that's just as bad. Because worship brings you much closer to Jesus. I don't believe in science. Science has nothing to do with what I'm talking about. Science has nothing to do with God. No, it's not a chip. It's symbolic. It's what you think to do in your head and what you do with your hand. It's in your forehead and your hand. Hi, Happy New Year. It's your thought processes, your thought and your actions. Well, I don't care if science is provable. Science is nothing I base anything on. I base what I'm talking about on God and His Word. That's what I'm basing it on. And the thing of it is, if you don't believe in anything, if you don't worship God, you're worshiping the devil. Then you believe in Satan, because you can't sit on the fence. And that's the sad thing. And you will be lost someday if you don't worship at all. So it's best that you start going to church. No, there is not going to be no microchip. I know a lot of people have said there's going to be a microchip. They're waiting to get the microchip. We know we have chips in our phones. We have chips in our debit cards and things like that. But there's going to be no chip put in our bodies at all. It's a symbolic mark. You got to understand that. God knows who'll be taking the mark. He's all knowing. He knows everything, but you need to come out of those Sunday keeping churches. Don't get caught and take the mark with not meaning to. Well, no, you don't really have to take communion every Sunday. When we were in a Lutheran church, we did, but God doesn't say you have to take communion every Sabbath or every Sunday for that matter. We, as long as you recognize that you're about Him in the Last Supper, as long as you take communion, then it's fine. We do it every quarter because that's the way we do it. The thing of it is, I feel so much closer to Jesus too, taking the communion. It draws me much closer. I mean, you taking that wine or taking the grape juice and taking that bread and things like that, it draws you that much closer to Jesus. And it doesn't really matter how often you take communion, as long as you take it. No, it's not gonna be a card. It's just gonna be a symbolic mark. You don't get baptized quarterly. You get baptized once, and that's all you need is one baptism. Once you're baptized, that's it. You don't get baptized again unless you fall away, and that's when people get baptized again. But I got baptized over 40 years ago. And my baptism stands. Yeah, the mark on is invisible. You're right. There is no where you're going to be a chip. I know that's where people, you don't have to get baptized that many, because the Bible talks about one baptism. One faith, one Lord, one baptism. You can't believe in God and be gay, for the simple fact that being gay is not Christian. It is evil. And you need to come out of that lifestyle. That God does not want you to be in that lifestyle. He's very upset at you. He's probably crying because you're in that lifestyle. You need to leave it. It's not an impossibility for you to come out of that lifestyle. Just pray to God to help you, and He will. Because you can't stay in that lifestyle and expect to be saved, and you won't be. I know you don't want to be lost, but you can't stay in that lifestyle and expect to be saved, because you won't. He will not save you, because... And well, somebody said in here that they're gay. They don't want to be lost. But I know it might be like an addiction, but you need to stop that addiction. It's something that you can overcome if you choose to. You have to tell yourself, I don't want to be gay anymore, and you won't. Yeah, that's true. You're just, I'm not trying to crack you up, because I'm being very serious here. This is nothing to be laughing at. So I don't want to be cracking anybody up. I'm sorry that you feel that way. What lifestyle again? Well, somebody came in here and talked about being gay. They said that they don't want to be lost, but they can't give up the lifestyle. Well, if you can't give up your lifestyle, then you're automatically gay. I mean, if you can't give up your lifestyle, then you're automatically lost. That's plain and simple. I can't put it any simpler than that. It's an abomination to God, and you will not make it to heaven. You will be lost. So you choose. Do you want to be saved, or do you want to be lost? God can work with your heart, but you have to be willing to accept what he has to offer. Just ask him to help you come out of your gay lifestyle. Because there have been many times people have asked to come out of the gay lifestyle. And no, being gay is not fine. Being gay is not fine. I'm sorry to say you're wrong. Being gay is a sin. That's right. That's right. Exactly. You can't glorify God in your body if you're gay. He did not make gay people. You chose to be that way. You can unchoose to be that way too, but you don't want to. God is in control. I am not judging anybody. I'm just telling you what God says. And that's the thing. Gay is not fine. It is not fine and never will be. It's an abomination. You read that in the Bible. It's an abomination to God. If God wanted us to be gay, then he would have made two men and two women instead of Adam and Eve. He made Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. And I will argue with anybody on that point until doomsday, because that's right. It's in the Bible. And God said it. He said it, I believe it, and that settles it for me. When he says gay is wrong, it's a sin, it's an abomination, that's too bad, but you need to come out of it, because it's an abomination to God, and you will not make it. You will be lost. No, they were not clones. I'm tired of people, and that's an abomination. That's blasphemy to say they were clones. That's the thing. Yes, we're getting right back to Sodom and Gomorrah. Sodom and Gomorrah, there was a lot of gay... Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed because of homosexuality. You know, in this world, it's going to be destroyed for the very same reason. There's a lot of homosexuality in this world. It never used to be that way. That could very well be. They were abused. So then they chose to be gay. But that's the thing. You know, years ago, you didn't even hear about it. That's right. Clones come from Satan, not from God. God made Adam and Eve, and I don't like it when people say that they're just clones. I'm not trying to judge. I'm not judging. It's a warning. I'm telling you exactly what God said. Now, if I'm using the Bible and I'm saying what God said, no, you can't be gay for Jesus. I'm sorry. You can't be gay and be a Christian. It does not work. You're either gay and for Satan, or you're for Jesus and a Christian. That's all. Plain and simple. You cannot be both. So, you can't be a gay Christian. There is no such thing as a gay Christian. And I will argue with that till doomsday, because it's not true. You can't be gay. If you're saying that you're happy to be for Jesus, that's fine. But if you're in a gay lifestyle, that's right. Gay people are going to go to hellfire. They're going to burn just like all the other wicked people are. And it's sad. You're going to burn up and you're going to be screaming in torment because it's going to be so painful. Yeah, and I know I'm going to pray for you, the gay people, that you come out of that lifestyle, because you need to. I think I'll pray right now. Dear Father in Heaven, have some gay people in here that don't understand what being gay really means. I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will convict their heart, that they will want to come out of that gay lifestyle and follow you. Because being gay, they can't be gay and they can't be gay and a Christian, Lord. And they want to be Christian, but they don't want to be lost. So I pray, Lord, your Holy Spirit will convict their heart, that they will get into the Word of God, and they will ask you to help them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So the thing of it is, people just don't understand that being gay and being Christian are two different things. You can't be gay and be Christian, and they don't go together. It's going to be seven times hotter. And if you want to burn in hellfire, then keep on doing what you're doing, and that's exactly where you're going to go. But let me tell you, you're not going to be laughing in hellfire. You're going to be screaming, because it's going to hurt so bad. You're going to want to die right away. Well, goodbye then, because I'm trying to tell you, so that's all I can tell you, because the thing of it is, people want to burn up. If they want to go in hellfire, they can go in hellfire. You know, that's terrible that they feel that way. They're thinking, that's right. That's sin is sin. That's right. And you got to call sin by its right name. God calls it sin. Why are we any different? We got to call it sin. You know, I know there's gays in the churches, there's transgenders and things like that, but that does not make it right. You know, we don't condemn them for what they are doing, but we're telling them that what they're doing is wrong. They need to make the choice. You need, you know, and it's hard to respect the gay people. You know, That's right. They love the sin more than the Savior. You're exactly right. I'm not really even sure that they even love Jesus. If they did, they wouldn't be gay in the first place. But that the thing of it is, he wants to take everybody to heaven, but not everybody wants to go there. And I hope that this message is getting across to people that we want you all there. Everybody in here wants these people that haven't accepted Jesus. We want you there. I mean, heaven is big enough for everybody if they just accept. And we know that not everybody's accepting. There's a lot of people going to be lost. I mean, the wicked people are going to encompass the whole earth. That's how many wicked people there are going to be. We don't want to be amongst that wicked people. We want to come out from among them and be ye separate. That's what the Bible says. Come out from among them and be ye separate. You're not really saying the truth if you want to be gay. The thing of it is, you can't be gay and be accepted by God. He accepts you as a sinner, yes, but he doesn't accept your sin. And he will never accept your sin. And if you want to choose to be gay, then you just can't go into heaven. That's all I'm going to tell you. You got to come out of that gay lifestyle. It's not an impossibility. You just have to choose and tell yourself that you don't want to be gay anymore. It's because it's very, very, very wrong. And you, No, I'm sorry. That is blasphemy. God did not say being gay is fine. Not when he said it's an abomination. Who told you that is the devil. You need to know who's talking to you. And I will not listen to somebody tell me that God says gay is fine. He never said being gay is fine. And how dare you say and call God a liar and say that God said it's fine. How dare you blaspheme God like that? No, he did not. It was the devil that did that. And you are gone. I'm sorry, but you're gone. There. That person's gone. There. Yeah. I blocked him, so you can't talk to him anymore. But the thing of it is, you can't get through to some people. Being gay is not fine. They want to accept the sin. That's the thing. They'd rather accept the sin and still be a Christian and think they can do what they want and be saved, but they don't understand. They can't do that. Because once saved, always saved is not even biblical either. Yes, I'm going to pray for him. You know, and I had to block him because he wouldn't get out of what he said. So I'm sorry for blocking him, but we'll just continue to pray for him anyway. You know, you heard me pray for him. But the thing of it is, I know you might be afraid, but you've got to come out of that gay lifestyle. You cannot stay in that gay lifestyle. I'm sorry. I'm telling you the truth, and everybody else is telling you the truth too. It's a terrible sin. He came to save us from our sin, and you're in sin so bad, so bad. You can come out if you choose to. You shouldn't be afraid to come out of sin. You should be afraid that you're good. You should be afraid to be lost and burn in hellfire. That's what you should be afraid of. That's what you should be afraid of. You should not be afraid to be saved and go to heaven with Jesus if you have accepted him. But burning in hellfire, yes, that's something to be afraid of, because it's no joking matter. It's not a laughing matter. The seven last plagues are no laughing matter either. They're going to be a terrible time for those people that take the mark of the beast. So I'm here to help you, and I want you to hope you come back at my Periscope, and I can help you again. Others can help you too, because we don't want you to stay in that gay lifestyle. It's so wrong, and I feel sorry for you. I'm hurting for you right now. Because I don't want you lost, and I know God doesn't want you lost either. You know, and it's sad when somebody thinks that they can be gay and be a Christian. You know, my heart really bleeds for you. It really does. I don't want to see you lost, and I hope that you change before it's too late. Because that's coming right around the corner. You know, the National Sunday Law. I know you say you understand, but I hope that you can follow through and just do what you need to do and come out of that and pray to Jesus to help you take it away from you. Because if you don't, you will be lost. And you're not going to want that, because hellfire is not going to be a process that you want to go through. You say it's hard, and you understand. I know it's probably going to be hard, but you can't do it on your own. Your strength comes from God. You have to ask for strength from God. So if you can't ask strength from God, you're not going to make it through. You need to ask strength from God to help you get through it. He's willing to help you. He's just waiting for you to ask him to help. He'll take that gay lifestyle right away from you. And you know something? Once he takes it away, you'll never want to go back to it again, because you'll have Jesus in your heart and you'll wonder why you never accepted him a long time ago. So please, please go to Jesus and accept him before it's too late, because I don't want you lost or anybody else. Because, you know, it's going to be a sad thing to be lost because you're in the gay lifestyle. Like I said, my heart really bleeds for you. Because there's a time of trouble coming such as never was, never will be. It's titled that because there is a national Sunday law coming, which is the mark of the beast. And that's coming right around the corner. That I'm telling people that if you don't come out of the Sunday-keeping churches, you're going to take the mark of the beast and be lost. And I don't want that for anybody, because we know there's going to be a lot of people lost because they're taking the mark of the beast. And I come in here, and it's not an easy thing to do. This is prophecy, and it's not something that's easy to preach on, because a lot of people don't want to accept it. They call it malarkey and everything else, but it's very serious. I'm very serious here. I wouldn't be in here talking like this if I weren't serious. I want people to be saved, and God does too. And people in here that are already saved that are Christian want you to be saved too. You just have to be willing to accept it. You know, the mark of the beast is coming right around the corner. And if you go to church on Sunday, you're going to be lost. And I don't want that for anybody. And we know there's going to be a lot of them lost because they take the mark of the beast. Us that aren't going to take the mark of the beast, we're not going to be lost, but we're not going to be able to buy or sell either. But our bread and water will be sure. God said so. We're going to have to flee for our life and go to an angel will come and take us to where we need to go to and hide from those that are trying to take our life. We know that some people will lose their lives. Yes, there'll be some martyred for the faith. But we should be willing to die for Jesus. Well, I'm sorry, but when it comes to the mark of the beast, yes, you have freedom of choice. You have freedom of choice to worship on any day you want. But he has to do it because so many people have turned their back on God. They've turned their back on the Sabbath, and that's why he's doing it. It's being brought on because people have denied him and have denied the Sabbath for so long. He has no choice but to destroy them. He doesn't want to. He doesn't delight in destroying the wicked. But what choice does he have? They've chosen everything else but the things that are not, everything that's not of importance over God. And that's so sad. They've chosen maybe their gay lifestyle or all their sins that they're in. They've chosen that over God and turned their back on God. And you can't do that. And the thing of it is, you're not once saved, always saved is not biblical either. You can lose your salvation because your name can be blotted out of the book of life. And that's right, worldly things. We've got to keep our mind off these worldly things and get our mind on God, because time is so very, very short. That's right. No one sin is greater than another. Sin is sin, no matter what it is. We need to call sin by its right name. And that's what I do when I come in here. I come in here and trying to warn people. I love everybody. I have no qualms about saying that I love the gay people. I love Muslims. I love all people. But it's just what they do is so wrong. And it's an abomination to God. And that's why I tell people that they're going to be lost in their sins. They're going to die in their sins if they don't come out of them. You know, and they can do it if they really want to. They just have to pray and ask Jesus to take it away. You know, but I think I'm about ready to call it quits for now, because my voice is getting a little hoarse. I ran out of things to drink and my voice is getting hoarse, and I need to rest it, because I may come back again tonight. But I thank all of you for coming in here, and I hope you all have a blessed and safe and happy new year. Don't get out and drive if it's bad weather or anything like that. Stay home and you're very welcome, and get into the Word. Oh, I'm glad you did. But like I said, I don't get I don't take any glory for this. I give all the glory to God. But I thank you for coming in here, and I pray that you all have a safe and happy new year. And I love you all. And bye bye.